Good afternoon, everyone. I'm Fred Kemp. I'm President and CEO of the Atlantic Council, and I'm delighted to welcome you all to this important event on the coronavirus pandemic and global cooperation. Let me underline that again, global cooperation. Let me start first and foremost by welcoming Dr. Deborah Birx, the White House Coronavirus Response Coordinator. And each of the ambassadors, also from D10 Allies and Partner, and I'll introduce the ambassadors later. And Dr. Birx, we embrace the notion of physical distance, but not of social distance. And we think through these events, we bring a global community much closer to take on a global crisis, a global tragedy, which has hit the worst pandemic in a century, the worst economic downturn since the 1930s, and we're all in this together. The Atlantic Council, we're driven by a mission of shaping the global future together with friends and allies by galvanizing U.S. leadership and engagement with our partners. We're committed to providing leaders platforms to exchange ideas as well as strategy and policies necessary to shape the post-pandemic world for the better. In that spirit, and since the crisis began this spring, the Atlantic Council has convened a series of private conversations with ambassadors from the D10, 10 leading democracies in the world. These D10 ambassador roundtables are intended to help promote greater cooperation between the leading democracies on the pandemic. This is all part of our Democratic Order Initiative in the Brent Scowcroft Center for Strategy and Security. This is the first time we're convening this group in a public setting, as we thought it would be useful to have an open conversation about global cooperation on these challenges. We're delighted to welcome viewers from C-SPAN, listeners from C-SPAN Radio, PBS NewsHour is streaming, live streaming, and many others are tuning in as well. So thank you so much in this virtual audience. Following the ambassadors' conversation, we'll move to a panel of leading experts here at the Atlantic Council who will discuss their new assessments on the pandemic's geopolitical impact. During this part of today's discussion, we'll turn our attention to scenarios and strategies for shaping the crisis, highlighted by three new papers on the pandemic that we're pleased to release publicly today. This is part of the Atlantic Council's Strategy Paper Series, which is the flagship product of the Council's Scowcroft Center. We're delighted to have Dave Lawler, World Editor at Axios, joining to moderate that later discussion. The first of these papers, What World Post COVID-19, outlines three scenarios for future world order. A deglobalized and competitive and somewhat incoherent world. A future, number two, a future where China comes out on top, but there's great rivalry among leaders and divisions in the world. And a third scenario where the world comes together, US global leadership continues, and we all reinvigorate the world together for the common good. And you can guess which one of these outcomes the Atlantic Council might prefer. The second paper considers the current state of the pandemic and how it has strained the global rules-based order over the past few months. The final paper today is a strategy paper shaping the post-COVID-19 world together. It provides a global strategy for us and allies, both to recover from the current crisis, but also to rejuvenate, not just leave the same, but rejuvenate a functioning rules-based system. So with that, let me turn to the first part of this program, an interactive roundtable discussion with the ambassadors and Dr. Birx and other officials with us today. After about 45 minutes or so, we will open the floor for a few minutes of Q&A from the audience. And so if you have a question, submit it through the Q&A function on Zoom, and we'll try to get in as many as we can. So I'm going to very, very briefly introduce each of the participants so we can get to work. Dr. Deborah Birx from the White House Coronavirus Task Force, Ambassador Stavros Lambrinidis from the EU, Ambassador Arthur Sinodinos from Australia, Ambassador Armando Varicchio from Italy. We also have the Deputy Chief of Mission, the Deputy Chiefs of Mission from Japan, from Germany, from South Korea, from the British Embassy. Also, we have a Senior Counselor from the French Embassy, And we also have the Minister for Political Affairs from the Embassy of Canada. You'll see in this this portion of the program, it's a more male-dominated program than these D10 offerings usually are. And that's because, unfortunately, the ambassadors from Canada, Australia, and Germany, all of whom are women who we know and have worked with very closely, were able to have sent their apologies that they couldn't attend today. But Dr. Birks, let me start with you. Thank you again for joining us. I know that you've got other things to get to, so I know you'll have to leave us early in this session, but let's see if we can get a couple of questions and some reflections of yours before you have to do that. We're here to discuss the importance of global cooperation on the pandemic. So how would you assess U.S. efforts to work collectively with allies and partners to confront the pandemic so far? What can the administration do to enhance global coordination? And I would be remiss in this setting, with as many people tuning in, if you didn't give us a little bit of a overview also at home, how are we going to get the situation out of control, and just how bad is it going to get?
Great, thank you. And thank you for this opportunity with the Atlantic Council. And thank you for my colleagues from around the world, who are my colleagues on all the multilateral boards that I sit on, from the Global Fund to UNAIDS. And I just want to take the start out by really thanking the countries who are represented here. When many of my European colleagues, who I've known well, were confronting this virus, they would drop everything to give me the specifics of what they were seeing. They were about between 14 and 20 days ahead of us, except for the UK. And the ministers of health from Spain, Portugal, Germany, and Italy would write me about what they were seeing. And that was tremendously important for us, because when the virus came to our shores, we knew really who we had to really protect. We had some insight of who would have the most severe outcomes. And that came from my colleagues around the world. And so that global cooperation, which sometimes is not visible at the highest stage, works every single day. And every single day, we've been able to be in communication. And I think you saved a lot of people in the United States by sharing that information early on when you were confronting your own issues in each of your countries. I think what surprised all of us in the developed world is how much of an impact this virus and this respiratory pandemic is having disproportionately on high-income and upper-middle-income countries. Having worked globally for most of my adult life, to have a situation where we always were worried about resource-limited settings and fragile health systems, yet this is a virus with the highest mortality in high-income and upper-middle-income countries. And that was unusual, and I think remains unusual. South Africa is having a significant part of this epidemic, but Sub-Saharan Africa in general has a very young population, which we now know is relatively spared in this pandemic. So many of the things that we prepared for globally, and certainly the United States have built a lot of global infrastructure, as well as all of the ambassadors represented here from Japan and JICA, all through the EU-EC, and certainly all of the bilateral investments and the multilateral investments that all the countries today make that are on this in health and health systems. And it was those systems investments, just to make it clear to everyone, that led to the ability of resource-limited settings to have the testing platforms and these other technologies. They were all built by the HIV and TB program. Every single test that's being run today is being run on platforms that were built around the world, support of HIV and TB. And so sometimes when we make these vertical investments, people say, well, it's a vertical investment. Well, if we had made those vertical investments around the world in TB and HIV and bought that equipment, there wouldn't be any tests today. And so that has been, I think, another evidence of the work that we do together has really led to a very successful, at least ability to be able to see this epidemic and see this epidemic on the ground. In the United States, we are very independent people. Each of our states are different. Each of our counties are different. Each of our metros are different. And you can see that now in the pandemic in the United States. The pandemic originally, like when it hit Italy and Lombardy region, it hit really very much in the Northeast, Chicago, Detroit, and New Orleans. And much of the rest of the country was spared. And I think many of the governors and mayors thought they would be forever spared through this. And so as they opened and began to see small cases, they were used to responding immediately to outbreaks and stopping the outbreak. And I think none of us really anticipated the amount of community spread that began in really our 18 to 35 year old age group. And I think this is an age group that was so good and so disciplined through March and April. But when they saw people out and about on social media, they all went out and about. And so we right now have really significant cases in people under 45. We're working very hard to protect those we know are most vulnerable. We're working very hard right now with every governor and every mayor to increase and flood testing into the areas to be able to really isolate individuals and isolate entire households and making sure that we're protecting the most vulnerable neighborhoods with through testing and isolation. And then working very hard with our hospitals to ensure better outcomes. And like many people, we see a really dramatic decline in our case fatality rates. And this is really because of the work that the Europeans did to teach us, the work that the UK did in providing the information on steroids, and the work that we're doing here in the United States to make remdesivir, important therapeutic, convalescent plasma, and now the studies we're doing with monoclonal antibodies. So I thank you for having me. Really, thank you for giving me this opportunity to really talk to my colleagues around the world who really supported us in our hour of need. And it has really been a tremendous dialogue between many of the countries that confronted this epidemic. And they're really a new way to look at pandemics, because I don't think any of us thought that 80% of the cases would be in high-income and upper-income countries, upper-middle-income countries, and almost all the mortality, probably 90% of the mortality, is in upper-middle and upper-income countries, probably due to our great comorbidities. We have a lot of hypertension, diabetes, and obesity in the United States, and I think it's really pointed out how we have to become a healthier nation together.
Dr. Birks, thank you so much for that. So I'm going to give you a snapshot of the first three questions I'm sending to the ambassadors. I know you have very limited time, so take two or one of them, but here, each of them I know is important to you, so I'll just lay them out, and I know you have to go to the White House, so let us know when your time is up. The first is really the issue of vaccine nationalism. And once a vaccine is discovered, is there a way to distribute it fairly or equitably? Will it be every nation for itself? Second question is to the question of China. As you know, Australia and the Australian ambassador is with us, has asked for an international investigation. Where are we in our relationship with China? And the third, and you've touched on this already, and so maybe we don't need to go back to this, but as you look around the world at the countries that have been most successful getting this under the control, what's the lesson? And then I'll be turning to the ambassadors after your answers on this for their answers.
Well, I'll be very quick. We are very excited about the discipline that many of the citizens of other countries have brought to this response. And I think we're working on that same level of discipline to really ensure that we have mandatory masks in every place where there's rapid spread, social distancing, source of hand hygiene, and really protecting those who are most at risk. On the vaccine side, and I'll do this really quickly, we have been collaborating across between Europe and the United States on development of vaccines. Obviously, we're working collaboratively with our British colleagues with their vaccine with Oxford and AstraZeneca. And I think we're working together to really, across multiple platforms of vaccines, to make sure that vaccines are available. The United States, of course, has always invested in global health. We are the largest investor in HIV, TB, and malaria around the world, not only investing dollars, but investing Americans around the world through our embassies, combating these diseases on the ground, working with our counterparts in nations around the world. And so I would imagine, like always, in all the work that we do, both domestically and globally, we will be there on the global health front, supporting the world in their response. One quick comment on China. I think, you know, I was traveling most of the time when this was happening through January and February, working primarily in sub-Saharan Africa. And I have to say, if we had known about the level of asymptomatic spread, I think we would have all looked at this differently. The delay in the information of human-to-human spread, and then the delay in the information about how transmittable this was and what the spectrum of disease was. I think we now know that there's an unusual spectrum of disease that we would not have predicted from very, really what we call asymptomatic disease in people under 30, where probably 50, 60% are completely asymptomatic, to mild disease, to moderate disease, and then really severe disease. I think if countries had known that at the beginning, there would have been a very different response to this. And I think not figuring that out until the depth of that asymptomatic disease. We always knew it was 15 to 20%, but finding out that it's 40 or more percent, I think if we had known that, and that's usually the initial country's responsibility to really get out information about the spectrum of disease. And I think that did delay across the board our ability to really see or look for this. We were looking for PQ.
So I wouldn't mind, as I want to go to the three ambassadors with us first, and each with a specific question, and I'll play off Dr. Birx's comments, and maybe I'll go to Ambassador Sinodinos first from Australia on the comments you just heard on China. I wonder if you could comment on what you just heard from Dr. Birx, and also where we are in this effort that you've trying to launch at the World Health Assembly to call for an international investigation on the origins and where this takes our relationship in general with China going forward.
Well, thanks, Fred, and always good to be with the Atlantic Council. And thank you to Dr. Birx for the work she's doing and for having the time to catch up with us here. Look, on the matter of China and the WHO, my government took a very principled stance early on that. Given the chatter that was going on within the Australian community and the way that this pandemic had spread so quickly through the developed world as well as now developing countries, our view was that we had to learn the lessons of what had happened, why did it happen, how did it get out, what we were likely to see in terms of how this would develop going forward, and what are the lessons from that for the world. And our view was that this should not be seen as just a cross-examination of China. I can understand how the Chinese might feel a bit defensive about this, but at the end of the day, this was really an exercise in asking the question, what happened? How did it happen? How can we do things better in the future? And I was heartened that at the World Health Assembly, countries adopted the resolution that Australia, and thank you to colleagues at the EU in this regard for their cooperation on this, adopted a resolution which has authorised an independent investigation. And this is an investigation which is now starting to happen. The WHO is in the process of liaising with the Chinese authorities, arranging visits and the rest. We'll see how far the cooperation goes, but it's in the interest of all of us, including the people of China, that we learn as much as we can about this and see how we can better prepare ourselves for the future. Because one of the lessons of this pandemics than not going forward. So we have to learn the lessons from these and we have to be better prepared. This was the big opportunity for the WHO. And out of this, we have to learn what they can do better going forward. We work with the WHO every day in different parts of the world, but particularly in our part of the world, in the Pacific, in the South Pacific. And we do a good job with them on the ground. But this is really about governance of the institution going forward to make sure that it can operate in a way which is in the interest of all members. And that's not to cast aspersions on the past. It's simply to say, let's learn from the past and let's go forward. And I think it's important, if possible, if we can disengage that exercise from the broader tensions that we see in the relationship between the US and China and between Western countries and China. That's another set of issues. Let's try and separate the issues out and get on with doing what needs to be done from a global health perspective.
Mr. Ambassador, I'll try to mix in some of the questions I see come in when they fit where we are in the discussion. And there's a question from Laura Kelly in the Q&A on Zoom on the U.S. withdrawal from the WHO, President Trump's action. And you just mentioned the WHO and the continued need for it. How does this impact, Laura Kelly asks, the global effort to combat the virus?
Well, I think the U.S. has made it clear that we'll continue to provide resources, as Dr. Birx mentioned, for the global health effort around this. I don't think it can necessarily impact directly on that, because the work of the WHO will also continue, and other countries have indicated that they'll step up if there is a gap. But I don't believe that there will be much of a gap going forward. I think that the US will cooperate with the work globally. I think that'll be fine. I think in relation to the WHO effort, they have made it clear now that the focus has to be on what is happening in the developing world and what's happening in Africa, in Latin America, in areas which have faced greater challenges. They're more resource limited. They may have less technical know-how. And one of the things that we're doing in our region is putting resources into the Southwest Pacific, putting resources into Indonesia and areas which may become particularly stressed over the next little while, either because of the health impact or the flow-on effect to their economies. So I believe there's a lot of resources out there to help address this, and the US has made it very clear that we'll continue to be part of those efforts in parallel with what is being done through the WHO.
Thank you very much, Mr. Ambassador. Ambassador Lambrinidis of the European Union.
But we are there, and we are working very closely with our American partners on trying to ensure that a
the health of our citizens, of our communities, but also as responsible members of the international community. We want to make sure that we create today the conditions for a better world after COVID. And in order to do so, we have to empower our own citizens, our own people. And this is the first lesson learned that we can draw from the fact that we have this somewhat unique privilege, if not very happy, to having been the first Western democracy to be so severely hit by the virus. I remember the last days of February when I started receiving appalling information from Italy, and I was starting discussing with colleagues here within the administration. There was a certain sense of unbelief. It was difficult to imagine the level of pain that our community is feeling, but this was the case. So we didn't have any handbook at hand. We didn't have any previous experience to take advantage of. So we had to take, since the very beginning, very tough measures. This was the responsibility of our government, both at national and local level, because in Italy, there is a shared responsibility between the national level and then the different regions across the country. But first and foremost, our people, the Italians, every single individual has played as a sort of first responder to behave responsibly, to comply to the very tough measures enforced by the government, but also to make sure that by his or her own behavior, there was a sort of limit barrier posed to the further spreading of the virus. So this is the first lesson learned. Second, I think relying very much on transparency, and I salute Dr. Bird's comments, what she said about her very effective cooperation with colleagues around the world and namely in Europe, because through transparency we can share information and substantiate science, because no political decision can be taken unless there is a sound science-based support. This is something that I think Italy proved to be absolutely crucial. But then, and I get back to my initial comment, as citizens of the world, we want to make sure that the world post-COVID is made more aware, more resilient, that through international cooperation we are able to cope with the present and future challenges. This also implies reshaping, in a way, our own meaning and understanding of national security, precisely because we want to make sure that our national security remains strong. We have to cooperate with other countries of the international community, particularly among the countries represented here in these countries. The EU and our closest friends and allies, because I think this has been absolutely crucial. As the first severely hit country, we're very grateful to what our friends, allies have been doing, providing support, help, critically needed, particularly in the very early days of the crisis. So I think this is important. A final comment on the EU, as my friend and colleague Stavros Lambrinidis was recalling, the EU since the very early days adjusted to the new situation. Health was not one of the traditional common policies of our institutions, but I think that in the light of the emergency, in the light of the dimension of this terrible crisis, the EU really proved to be critical. And I think that this is something that for us is very important. So complying at the level of communities, making our nations stronger, but also by doing so, acting as citizens of the world. This is absolutely crucial, and this is the strong determination of the Italian people and of the Italian government.
For both the Italian ambassador and the EU ambassador, very, very quick follow-up and with a brief answer, and this will be an undiplomatic question, but it comes from our listeners, watchers, from Rick Marker. Are you seeing the U.S. learning and implementing from what the world around us has learned? So is the U.S. learning? You both live in the United States, and you heard what Dr. Burke said about young people who are now out about and spreading. And secondarily, has the U.S., this comes from another question, has the U.S. been globally collaborative enough, or would you like to see more from the U.S.? Maybe first with you, Ambassador Varricchio, and then Ambassador Lambrinidis afterwards.
Of course, it's not for me to lecture about individual and collective behavior, but I think that Dr. Birds has been very candid in her comments that it is important that our communities show responsibility. This is something that proved to be quintessential. The very reason why we have been able to start reopening the country as of early June is precisely because we have been very careful in enforcing tight measures since the very first days. This is absolutely crucial. There is a very fine line between individual responsibility and collective responsibility. So I think this is important. As for the U.S. support, I'm very grateful to what the U.S. has been doing. The government, the administration, since the very beginning, provided us with critically needed equipment, PPE, ventilators. This has been absolutely crucial. The administration, but also different NGOs, and corporate America, the different members of the business community, companies active in Italy. So again, the American solidarity proved to be crucial in the country, and we're very grateful for that.
Ambassador Lambrinidis.
Thank you. Look, we all learn through this, and we're still learning. And the good thing is that we have very regular contacts, Europeans and Americans, to exchange our experiences and best practices, whether it is on how we try to fight the virus on the ground, or whether it is on the measures we're taking to restart our economies, or whether it is to what we do with vaccines around the world and supporting third countries. And I'm very pleased with the fact that we're having this this very fruitful cooperation. On our side, Fred, we saw that from the lowest level, as Ambassador Varricchio, my friend, just said, being able to instill in the people in Europe a sense of the urgency of this, and being able to coordinate among ourselves and to ensure that people bought in to the necessity of wearing masks, staying at home, taking measures that normally you would never take in Europe, and to do so collectively, that was of critical importance and of critical success. From the top down, from the bottom up, and in every stratum of society, there was a very clear sense that this was a crisis that every individual had a role to play to contain. And that created also a sense of pride in people, ensuring that if they did the right thing, they would be a very important brick in the wall that we had to build to stop this virus, which of course is not stopped, but it certainly has declined. Then we also learned that by working together to address this, the health consequences and the economic ones, we were much stronger. So from the beginning, for example, at the beginning there was great difficulty. Everyone was trying to, going out there, trying to get masks, trying to get ventilators, everyone for themselves. And we decided that that was not the right way to go, that EU member states should not be competing with each other in the world market to get the fundamental PPE. So we immediately did a collective procurement procedure, all member states through the European Union itself. And we managed, therefore, to basically procure vast amounts at relatively low prices of all these equipment because it was a joint effort. So that also is something that we learned. You know, we learn every day and we learn all the time. We listen to the scientists. We don't do whatever comes in our head. And for us, that has meant, in some instances, lockdowns that have been very strict. In my country of Greece, you know, people were locked down very quickly. You couldn't go out to the supermarket to buy something unless you SMS saying, that's where I'm going to be. You were checked if you were not doing all these things. So we understood that we had to send a message across that this is not the common flu. This is deadly. This is dangerous. And this is something that every citizen can fight and win if we took responsibility for it.
Thank you, Mr. Ambassador. So I want to circle back on the first issue now that we discussed, which was China. Dr. Birx was strong on that. Ambassador Sinodinos was also very interesting on this issue. I wonder if I could turn first to the Deputy Chief of Mission from the Embassy of Japan, Kazutoshi Aikawa. Sir, I wonder, as you heard what you saw, how do you feel about Beijing's response? How does Japan look at this? And also the call for the investigation. I know you've also been concerned by rising tensions with China, and I'd like to hear your thoughts on this question.
Well, of course, we are all for the international, countries working together to get to the bottom of this issue. So that's our basic, the position. So we'd be happy if, the international organization takes a lead in, getting to the bottom of all this issue, and that would be a huge contribution to the future undertakings.
In your own situation now, and maybe I'll take this from you and then also turn to our South Korean colleague, what's the status? How's the control in Japan at the moment? And then for our South Korean colleague after you, Mr. Aikawa, and this is Sung Hyun Moon, the Deputy Chief of Mission from South Korea. I wonder if you can also address the China question, and then after that, the situation in South Korea, where you seem to have struck the right balance between stopping the virus and reopening the economy. And everyone's been watching South Korea, but first back to you, Mr. Aikawa, on the situation in Japan.
The situation in Japan is that in total cases up to now is 22,000 cases, and mortality is 980. So it's relatively small compared to other countries, but still we have a lot of challenges ahead. And we just started out the reopening, the national reopening a couple of weeks ago. And we've been okay, but last week and this week, the number seems to be ticking up a little bit. And now it's every day 200 new cases emerges, and that's not something. And half of it is from Tokyo area, and that's not what I'd like. We'd like to see at this point in time. So we are very alerted to any possibilities of potential outbreaks, as we go ahead. And in China, there are. As Dr. Birx said, that there are a lot of issues, that we need to take into consideration. And number one is, of course, transparency, real-time transparent exchange of data is a key. and also sharing the lessons learned as expeditiously as possible is also key to in effectively responding to the pandemic. And second issue is, you know, that how we are going to create, adapt ourselves to the new normal and creating a new environment and society, in this pandemic and a post-pandemic world. That's a huge challenge for Warsaw as a D10 countries. And I third is that, this pandemic has exposed another challenge, which is how we are going to create supply chain, ensuring the free flow of medical essential goods and equipment. So that's something that we need to have in mind. And lastly, in preventing the further spread of the virus, the chain is only as strong as the weakest link. So the D10 country, has been at the forefront in helping to strengthen the weakest link. And we need to, lead by example. And I, particularly, as we work with the developing world with the fragile system. So these are the things that we need to, to give a thought as we move ahead, and particularly how we are going to work with China.
I was on mute. I apologize for that. I was on mute. I'm going to turn to Mr. Moon, before I do that, if you have questions, send them to the Q&A function on chat. You can also send questions into Twitter with hashtag stronger post COVID. Hashtag stronger post COVID. Or you can tweet. This is one thing you're experiencing here by watching this is you're experiencing the D10 format. So Prime Minister Johnson of the UK wants to use this format to take on 5G issues and other issues. More and more people are writing about the value of a format bringing together the world's leading democracies. And so you're seeing this in action here, and it's just wonderful to have all these speakers pitching in. I think, Mr. Moon, you can share with us what lessons should the world be taking from South Korea's success? What could be applied elsewhere from that? And you may also have a comment on the China question.
Thank you. Thank you very much. First of all, let me just explain what's going on in South Korea. In Korea, after passing a peak of 909 cases per day, at the end of the February, we managed to mitigate the pandemic. And for the last few weeks, we have kept new confirmed cases 2-digit per day. As of today, we have total of the 13,000 confirmed cases with 44 new ones. It's pretty good figure. What is secret behind it? I would say that as Dr. Burks mentioned that Korean people might be a little bit disciplined compared with other democracies, but at the same time, we try to be very faithful to the fundamentals. That fundamental means that wearing masks in daily life or strict social distancing are important tools to lower the number. But at the same time, mass testing in the case of Korea and the effective tracing have also contributed tremendously to our fight. So now we have turned the social distancing into distancing in daily life. And at the same time, we also need to do address the economic fallout from this COVID-19. So the Korean government has taken whatever steps are necessary to address the challenges, including the unprecedented three supplementary budget totaling $50 billion. I would like to share 2 points concerning how to balance between the public health concerns and the economic reopening. One is that no economic reopening will be sustainable without securing a strong public health. Although we have had occasional spikes in cases, the public has maintained confidence that government had control over the virus. This has allowed us to avoid stay-at-home orders or mass closures of most businesses because people have faith in the safety of the places they are going. Because of this sustained period, we will need to fight the COVID-19. There is a tendency to rush to reopen the economy. A certain level of the fatigue has also helped this trend, but it is something we should avoid. Ultimately, there are no benefits in reopening the economy if you do not have the virus under control. When an outbreak happens, people stay home, whether the government has ordered them to do so or not. But by controlling the virus and keeping case levels down, you convey confidence that things are safer and can reap the benefits of reopening the economy. That is why I think it is so important that public maintains trust in the government's ability to keep things under control. And the, another kind of the lesson or thought that I want to share with you from the Korean case, that is that in the case of Korea, we never fully shut down our economy. So Korea hasn't had to deal with the reopening things so much as reintegrating everything that has been interrupted. Korea understands the importance of the movement of people for economic success. But right now, with so many countries under lockdown and imposing significant restrictions, that segment of the economy is suffering. So we are trying to facilitate the ability of business people to move across borders again between because these movements serve as a significant economic impetus. We are working with our neighboring countries, including Japan and China, to create fast-track procedures which will allow business people who have to travel between countries to expedite the review process that many countries still have restricting travel. Now, more than 10,000 Korean business people have received special exemption from 16 countries through fast track and other arrangement. And then on the case of the China, I think, I mean, I agree that there needs to be some international investigation, the origin of the, this COVID-19 issues. But it is important also, I mean, not to use, I mean, that to blame a specific country, but to use it to prevent the resurgence of the similar pandemic in the future, at the same time to respond more quickly and effectively in the event of such a crisis. At the same time, this COVID-19 crisis also, I mean, brought about the issues of the economic fallout, so that the global community need to work together not only to defeat this virus, but also to reviving the global economy. In that regard, we need also include, I mean, Chinese efforts, how they can contribute to the revival of the world economy. Thank you.
That's a wonderful answer. I think without saying it, sir, you sort of gave the answer to whether the United States is learning adequately from others. And my guess that the answer would be no. You may have given us one of the best quotes of the session, which is, the Koreans might be a little more disciplined than other democracies. And I think you also gave us reasons of tracing and others. That's a really, really interesting insight. I'd like to turn to Michael Tatum, the Deputy Chief of Mission from the British Embassy. You organized a global vaccine summit. The UK organized a global vaccine summit in June. You heard the comments of Dr. Birx and Ambassador Lambrinidis on this. How do you look at this danger of every nation for itself on vaccines, and also with the UK as a leading healthcare provider in terms of its companies? Once a vaccine is discovered, is there a way to distribute it and fairly and equitably, or is it every nation for itself? Michael Tatum.
Thanks very much, Fred. I think you've put your finger on what is really crucial here. And the key point is that once a vaccine is successfully identified and tested, it will need to be globally accessible. And that puts a real premium on international collaboration, which links to the theme of this session of global cooperation. And I think, you know, with vaccine development, there are two aspects to the challenge. Part of the challenge is scientific and carrying out the necessary research and the testing at speed. And part of the challenge is practical, how to ensure that any vaccine that is successfully developed and tested can then be quickly manufactured at scale, can be affordably priced, and can be globally accessible, including and indeed especially to those countries which will be needing it most. So I think there's some really important challenges here. I think there are positive developments to report in terms of efforts to counter and mitigate the risk of what you described, Fred, as vaccine nationalism. Looking at the UK experience and our engagement on this, we're engaging at several levels. Within the UK, two of the leading candidates for vaccine development are under development in the UK at Oxford University and Imperial College London. Both are currently in clinical trials, and the British government has been investing substantially in supporting that work, as well as in opening a UK's first vaccine manufacturing and innovation centre. But the UK is also engaging heavily in international collaboration, and you referred to the Global Vaccine Summit on the 4th of June, which the UK hosted. We felt that was a really successful event. The amount pledged at that event exceeded by some distance the target that had been set, and both the UK and the US, in fact, made sizable pledges at that event. We are also addressing this challenge through a number of other mechanisms. We've pledged a substantial amount to the Coalition for Epidemic Preparedness Innovations for the development of a COVID vaccine. We are supporting the ACT Accelerator, which is a global initiative that was launched by the WHO in April to speed the development, production, and equitable access to COVID-19 test treatment and vaccines. We are supporting the advanced market commitment that has emerged through within the Gavi framework, which was launched at the June summit, which is designed to accelerate access to vaccines for low and middle income countries. And I think we see this as potentially a key building block towards the global mechanism for equitable access to future vaccines. And all I've mentioned Gavi and the Global Vaccine Summit on several occasions, and I think this is also an opportunity to talk about the importance of vaccine work in the round. Aside from its focus on COVID-19, we see Gavi as having a vital role to play in sustaining broader immunization coverage during this period of disruption and bolstering the resilience of primary healthcare systems across the world. So I think, you know, that there are a number of initiatives and funding mechanisms that are specifically designed to counter the risk of vaccine nationalism. It can sometimes be sort of challenging to sort of mentally disentangle them from one another, but I think it's a very positive sign of the level of international commitment and will that this many mechanisms and schemes exist or are under development. So I am optimistic that a lot of good stuff is going on to mitigate the risk of vaccine nationalism. A lot of work is going on vaccine development. A lot of funding is being made available, and mechanisms are being put in place to support global access. Thank you, Fred.
Fred, I'm afraid that you're muted.
Fred, I believe you're still muted.
That's so embarrassing. I'm sorry. I'm trying to keep people out of noise and my ambient household noise. And instead, you missed the news. The news, first of all, I was thanking Michael, and thank you for engagement in the D10. But the news that's just in, it's a Washington Post alert that the Trump administration sends a letter withdrawing U.S. from World Health Organization over coronavirus response. The notice has been delivered to the UN Secretary General Guterres. And that would lead me to my question for our colleague from Germany, the Deputy Chief of Mission from the Embassy of Germany, Rickliff Beuthen. Mr. Beuthen, with that announcement, we knew it was coming, but now it's come. The role and efficacy of the WHO has been a subject of a lot of debate. It's been criticized for being too close to China, too slow to react. At the same time, Chancellor Merkel has been a strong advocate of the WHO, and the WHO has been playing an important role in seeking to control the virus, particularly in the developing world. So I wonder if you could give us your view from Germany, both on the role of the WHO and on and what impact, and this is a question from Jinta Polubinskas, professor of political science from West Virginia State University. How will this withdrawal of the U.S. affect the ability of the U.S. and its allies to find a way forward to act cooperatively to recover from the pandemic? Mr. Boitin.
Well, thank you, Fred. Thank you to the Atlantic Council for having me, and thank you for everyone who's here with me. And thanks for the question. Let me make three points, what I think is important here in this whole crisis. First of all, it's understanding what we're up against, right? This virus doesn't stop at any borders. It doesn't stop at any sort of form of government. It doesn't care about ideologies. So it's really about a threat that is very palpable in its global nature, maybe more than other threats that we see on a global scale. So understanding what we're up against and what the science behind it is first. Then the second thing is, and many ambassadors in this circle have alluded to it, it's about solidarity. We can only tackle it and overcome it together. This means solidarity between countries and solidarity, frankly, in our societies. And many in this round have talked about this, Dr. Birx in the beginning and then other colleagues afterwards, and how it is difficult to get your societies to act that way. But we've been pretty successful in many countries in doing it by explaining what is necessary and what the nature of the threat is. Now, thirdly, I think we need tools to be effective to overcome this threat internationally. We need international tools, and some of these tools are international organizations, and upfront in this challenge is the WHO. So you mentioned this, the German Chancellor, the German government, but frankly also the German society is very supportive of the WHO because we feel this is a crucial organization in the fight against COVID-19, but against many pandemics that we've seen in the past, other diseases around the world, and the WHO doesn't only work in Geneva, but it works around the world and on the ground. So we feel it's very important. Having said that, and Germany, if I may add, we're supporting the WHO very much in politically, but also with money. The German health minister has pledged that Germany would pay 500 million euros this year alone to the WHO because we feel it is so important. But having said all this, this does not mean that we should not learn from the crisis and evaluate what we did well and what we may not have done so well. So in the past, when we had Ebola, there was criticism of the World Health Organization, and changes were made, and the organization adapted, and it's the case here again. So while criticism is welcome, it's not only allowed, it is welcome, it may be justified, we feel that it is not a good idea to hamper the organization while in the full thrust and brunt of this pandemic. Now, we do support the need to reform it, the organization, but also international health regulations. We must talk about this. The Australian ambassador in the beginning mentioned a resolution by the World Health Assembly that mentioned some of these processes that we need. And we're all for talking about how to make the organization better, but we feel that we need it and we will need it in the future to overcome this challenge. So, we are a bit worried about attempts to not take part in it, because our feeling is the world would be a better place if we all worked to make the organizations that we have, and especially the World Health Organization, better.
Thank you. Thank you so much, Rick Califf. I appreciate that answer. We're down to the last few minutes of this first opening round, and I'm going to turn to my Canadian and French colleagues to bring this home, building off the German intervention on multilateral organizations. during the second panel, we're going to hear about strategies, not just for defeating the virus, but also rejuvenating the international system in the light of the crisis and advancing the rules-based order. We, the Atlantic Council, don't want to just go back to the state before, but it'd be nice to actually come out better. So I'm going to raise a question for Martin Loken, the of Canada, and also for Benjamin Roig from France. Canada's been leading efforts to promote multilateral cooperation. Do you see opportunities to not just capture and get back to the global system we once had, but maybe rebuild it in the aftermath of the pandemic? We do have a question from our chat room from Michael, which says, which organization do you see as being the central driver of a post-COVID rules-based system of international cooperation, perhaps? And how can it be truly global and consequential if key players chose not to participate? And I'd also like to ask the same question of our French colleague. Both France and Canada have been leaders in the multilateral system in the past, and I'd like to hear from both of you to close this session on how we take this period of time and contribute to the global system. And as you go to answer that, I also have a comment from Steve Wine that will make you be more frank in your answers, where he thanks the South Korean representative for being so fact-based and so frank in his answers. So let's see what we can say that will get us to the other side in the multilateral community.
Okay, Fred, I can start, so thank you. I would start by saying that the multilateral system, the rules-based international order, has been under all kinds of stresses and strains for several years now. So COVID, comes along and it adds yet another test for the system. But I think it also adds something of an opportunity for us. It's clear what we heard from Dr. Birx and what we've heard from the various embassy representatives. This is obviously a global threat. We have to work together internationally to defeat this virus. And the rules-based international system really is essential for us to accomplish together what any of us cannot accomplish all alone. We need the best minds in the world to develop the vaccines, the therapies, the treatments, and so on. So, for our part, we're very strongly committed to a robust global effort to deal with COVID-19 and all of the kind of devastating effects on health and societies and economies that we've been seeing. So, there's lots of good, important work going on right now in the G7 context, in the G20 context, throughout the UN, including the WHO, and elsewhere. And, Canada's been active in all this. We've been putting money behind it, $1.5 billion announced over the last few months for various aspects of the global response to COVID, support for the World Health Organization and other UN agencies, bilateral support, support for CEPI, Gavi, and so on. So that's going to be really important for us all to continue that kind of thing. And in parallel with all of these sort of formal structures that already exist, I'm encouraged by the number of sort of informal ad hoc things that we've seen emerge in the last few months. For example, there's a group of just over a dozen foreign ministers that have been meeting regularly, that the Canadian foreign minister convened this group, but regular meetings to talk about various aspects of our responses to COVID. I think along with our UK colleague, the two development ministers chair another group of a dozen or so development ministers from around the world, again, to talk about coordinating various aspects of the response to COVID. So I think these are important efforts, as is this one. I mean, the D10 work and the work of the Atlantic Council to support and convene this group of countries, I think, is another important strand of effort. To help us, ultimately build a stronger, more effective rules-based system to deal with, the next pandemic and the other challenges that are no doubt coming our way. So I'll leave it there, Fred.
Thank you so much, Martin. I really appreciate that answer. And let me turn to my French colleague.
Well, thank you, Fred, and thank you for having me. So as
as far as we are concerned, from the outset of the crisis, France has been convinced that we will not overcome it without a strong international solidarity on the sanitary or an economic front. And maybe to answer to the question of what the future of multilateralism to respond to this crisis, maybe we should first detail the different aspects of our current response to the COVID-19 crisis, which will shape the post-COVID world for what we are doing. And so just in a nutshell, on the global response to COVID-19, France has been particularly committed to increasing aid to the most vulnerable countries, especially in Africa. President Macron is personally.
I think we may have just lost France. So I think if we have our French colleague back, let's see if we get our French colleague back. We've just about run out of time, but I wouldn't mind turning back for maybe 30 seconds, a minute each, to each of the ambassadors, the Australian ambassador, the Italian ambassador, the EU ambassador, just if you have one comment you want to make on what you've heard thus far to help close us out. And if our French colleague comes back, we'll turn back to him. Let me turn first to the Australian ambassador.
Two quick points, Fred. The first is on vaccine development. I think we're all agreed the need for a global effort to make sure that we maximize the prospects of those countries which can least afford development of a vaccine to have equitable access to a vaccine. Australia is involved in a number of efforts along those lines. My second point is that we need to take biodefense as seriously as we take military defense. And I think one of the things coming out of this and the informal groupings our French colleague or our Canadian colleague talked about is thinking further about what is, in terms of like-minded countries, a biodefense strategy where we can pool our resources because of the potential for future pandemics. And I'll leave it there for now.
Thank you so much for that intervention. Ambassador Verrecchio.
Oh, thank you, Fred. I think we came up with a strong determination to reinforce international cooperation, particularly amongst friends and allies. As was mentioned in the democracies, the D. This is absolutely crucial. Also the point that national security can be better served in a collective way. I think that what the Australian ambassador was suggesting, that biodefense and health are a quintessential component of our security, is something that is there to stay. The post-COVID world certainly will look differently to this kind of issues. Pandemic is not necessarily an event that might look as science fiction. This is something that might come back, and our systems have to be made more resilient and aware. On this, and this is the great news, I think, our citizens will be very much determined. It's not always easy for democracies to ask parliaments to devote resources to national defense, to address security issues. On this, I think that our citizens did realize that it is absolutely crucial. This is where governments will have to focus in the post-COVID world.
So before I turn to, thank you so much, Mr. Ambassador, before I turn to the EU ambassador to close, let me go back to my colleague from France who has reappeared with his United States map behind him. Luckily, not a heat map of COVID infections, but let's see if we can turn to you for just a brief moment, sir.
Yeah, thank you, Fred. Sorry, I don't know what happens. So just maybe to conclude from what I was saying about the need of strong international solidarity and maybe the possibility that we shape the post-COVID world from now. Just a couple of words about the plan presented by President Macron and Chancellor Merkel last May. which provides a real European roadmap for the post-COVID world. And to conclude, to precise that France and Europe have also strong ambition in the field of climate and environment, and especially to say a couple of words about the third edition of the Paris Peace Forum, which will be devoted to the multi-actor response to coronavirus, with the conviction that we can collectively overcome the enormous challenges before us and use the crisis as an opportunity to rebuild a more sustainable world. So beyond the necessary emergency measures that we have to take now, including for developing countries, our goal is to kickstart and sustain activity. We need to build economies that are more fair and inclusive, and productive systems that are environmentally sustainable. Thank you.
And thank you for taking the trouble to come back to join us again. We really appreciate that. Ambassador Lambrinidis, please, why don't you close for us? And in your closing, if you can make some news by telling us that it's 100% certain the EU will mutualize debt, that would be a great way to close as well.
Well, you know, we've taken a huge step on that last point there, Fred.
It's amazing. I never thought we'd see the...
It really is. It's not just that we're creating this recovery fund, that the proposal is for a huge amount of money, but also that the EU collectively will get this money with the support of all our member states, and it will be distributed also in those areas of the economy in those countries that are most hit by COVID. So there's solidarity in extraordinaire here. I'll close with this, focusing on my Italian colleagues' emphasis on the D, the democracy. What is the added value that we can bring among the many added values in this debate? And in my view, it is to focus on values and to see at what in fighting Corona brings that about. Tracing apps and health apps have proven to be remarkably important in helping us come out of this, and they will prove in the next months to be probably the number one thing that sustains our economies. Now, these apps are extremely intrusive of privacy, and in the hands of authoritarian governments, they can turn a society into one where a government knows what you feel or what you think and why you think or feel it before you even do. So when we look at where the world will be going post-COVID, and digital and artificial intelligence will be right there at the center of the next many decades in all our societies, we have to decide who will set the standards for those things. Because in a democracy, it is not governments who are supposed to be observing and judging the thoughts and the actions of their citizens every day. It is citizens who are supposed to be observing and judging the thoughts and the actions of the governments. And if we go from the latter to the former, we have turned democracy on its head. Now, the countries in this virtual room, the D10 democracies, have a very strong interest in ensuring that the standards that are set for all these technologies in the future are standards that are based on human rights, on transparency, and on democracy, and that they're not standards that are exported by others based on repression. And I see an opportunity here in EU-US cooperation, a huge one, but also in working with every other country in this room to make this happen. It's going to be a challenge, and it's going to be big. You know, we're looking at the trees right now, but we have to look at the forest at some point, and the forest is the world we're going to be building after this. And it has to be equitable. It has to take care of economic inequalities. It has to be a solidarity-based world, and it has to be a free world. And those who might not be hoping we'll get to that place should know that the D10 people in this room are committed to take us to the right place here.
Thank you for those final comments and underlining the sentence, and it has to be a free world. What an exciting group of people, Dr. Birx from the White House, the ambassadors of the EU, Australia, and Italy, representatives of Japan, Germany, South Korea, the UK, Canada, France. I think the EU ambassador is right, is if this group of countries can act in common cause, also alongside the EU, there's not much that one can't take on. With that, I want to close this panel and turn to the next one. The Scowcroft Center has done amazing work on the geopolitical implications of COVID-19. We started looking at the post-COVID-19 world almost from the beginning of this period because we saw that it would be disruptive and it would not leave the world unchanged. Our analysis has made headlines, informed decision makers, and we're delighted to launch our paper series today. So we are also delighted to have David Lawler, I read him regularly, joining us to moderate this panel. He's world editor at Axios. Few have covered the global impact of the virus as well as he has. And with that, I'm going to turn to Dave to kick us off and thank everyone who participated in the first panel again for the time they took and all of you for sticking with us through it. Dave, over to you.
Thanks so much, Fred, and I'll echo your thanks to everybody who took part in the last discussion. I found it fascinating. I was very happy to listen along to it and thrilled to be hosting part two now, which will really pick up right where the last one left off, looking at the world beyond the pandemic and more specifically at the world order beyond the pandemic and how this global crisis is going to reshape international institutions, rivalries, leadership, and how the existing world order can be revitalized and in order to reshape those outcomes in a more positive direction. So as Fred mentioned, the Atlantic Council has been grappling with those questions in a series of papers, which you'll be hearing more about. And I'd encourage you all in the audience to check out. And our brilliant panelists are going to help us grapple with those questions today. They all have long and distinguished resumes, but I'm going to stick with just their current titles for now in the interest of time. We have Barry Pavel, who's director of the Scowcroft Center for Strategy and Security at the Atlantic Council. We have Rebecca Katz, who's director of the Center for Global Health Science and Security at Georgetown. We have Julia Friedlander, who's deputy director of the Global Business and Economics Program at the Atlantic Council, and Matthew Burrows, who's director of the Foresight Strategy and Risks Initiative at the Atlantic Council. And for all of you in the audience, I would encourage you to keep submitting questions in the Q&A function. I'm going to try to integrate them throughout, but certainly leave some time to turn to your questions as well. But for now, I'll start with Barry. As Fred mentioned, there's a new paper out about strategies for, essentially shaping the world after COVID-19 and perhaps helping shape our exit from this pandemic. And Barry, if you could just start maybe with the outlines of that strategy that you've been putting together and how it addresses the gaps that we've seen in the global order as this pandemic has played out over the last few months.
Sure, and thanks a lot. That's a great question, and the answer really benefits from that amazing discussion among the Democratic ambassadors. I think I'll just make four points that'll kind of couch the strategy in a context. I think point number one, the virus is a strategic shock. We should think about it that way. It's a threat to global order. And in non-wonky terms, that means it's a threat to the stability of the world on a pretty big scale. And that means if the negative scenarios come out, that means less security for Americans and citizens of democracies, less prosperity, and in some countries, even less freedom. Second point, the virus gets a vote. And so the huge uncertainty around how it might play out means that we need to lean heavily on scenario planning and strategy. So that's what we've been doing at the Scowcroft Center. You'll hear from Matt about scenarios. There's a three-part strategy paper series, ending with the third paper that outlines a strategy for navigating this post-pandemic global order. The Atlantic Council has taken as its mission to help the U.S. and other leaders drive the world toward the positive scenario that you'll hear Matt discuss. And a strategy means not just responding to a crisis, not just reacting, but accounting for the crisis as you're looking at longer term goals. Third point, any successful strategy really has to address multiple priorities because they're interconnected. So our strategy that's on the web right now outlines actionable suggestions in four areas: public health, the global economy, governance, and defense. All of this predicated on a sort of two-track approach in each of those areas. First, to lead a global recovery, and second, to aim big and try to sort of skip a generation to rejuvenate a new global system. Some of the ideas we can discuss more are a Countering Coronavirus Coalition among like-minded states. Secondly, for example, touting the huge successes of leading democracies in dealing with the pandemic. We heard from South Korea, but also Taiwan, Finland, New Zealand, and having much greater unity across the democratic world. Lastly, we identified a set of key principles to how to execute this strategy most effectively. First principle, what I call hyper-collaboration. We heard from the EU ambassador, we simply cannot do this alone. We have to work together, and that's the only way to do it. Second, China looms large, and so the strategy puts out a two-track approach. First track, work with a lot of countries, an inclusive group that includes China, on areas where we share common interests, counterterrorism maybe, climate, others. But a second track of collaboration among like-minded democracies, focus particularly on those areas where China is not constructive or presents a significant challenge. And then a third principle it's really worth reiterating is we don't just want to go back to recovery. We want to kind of skip a generation and lead a rejuvenation across these four areas. Digital capabilities are really the foundation for doing so. I think I'll end there because I really want to hear from the other panelists too. Thank you.
Thanks so much, Barry, for framing that for us. I want to turn to Matt. Matt, who is a geopolitical forecaster, which is not an easy gig in the best of times, but this is probably a particularly difficult time to see around the corner. So thanks for doing that for us. I've enjoyed reading your work on this issue and others. But you know, I think that we can all feel the world shifting around us at the moment, and everybody has different theories for which direction we're shifting in. So you have laid out three scenarios, Matt, and I wondered if you could sketch out those scenarios for us, and maybe if you would tell us which we seem to be on track for so far.
Okay, thank you. Thank you so much. Well, first, I mean, when you do scenarios, you're really talking about uncertainties. And I think we have four big uncertainties here. One is the virus itself, and I think we are still learning new things about the virus, and that has huge implications for, you know, how long things will be locked down, whether you can start the recovery. So and connected with it is also the vaccine. And I think we made a call very early thinking that until you get a vaccine, you're always going to be living in this limbo. And I think we're living through this now in this country where there was an expectation it would go down. And now we're seeing parts of the country suffer a rebound. So that's the second. Can you get a vaccine early enough? How long will it take? There are various opinions out there on it. The third is the economic recovery. And again, how fast? And you've heard all the letters, V, W, and so on. It's a big question. It's linked to, you know, the actual nature of the virus and also when you can get a vaccine. And the fifth is global leadership. And obviously that can steer in different directions. So the three are really, though you would say the worst, which is the great accelerator downwards. And this is taking, and you alluded to this, already existing trends that we've seen. So increased protectionism, greater deglobalization, huge tensions between US and China. And in many ways, COVID just ramps them up like steroids. And in that scenario, you really have a much longer period to get the vaccine than expected, so more than a year to 18 months. You have a much more difficult recovery for all the three major economic centers, so US, EU, and China. And you have tensions rising because of that increased protectionism, what you've already had before, and this leads to a sort of repeat of the 1930s. So I think this is still a big risk. I was greatly encouraged by some of the discussion the ambassadors had about the multilateralist efforts on vaccine, but I think we're still much more in this pathway of increasing U.S. Chinese tensions. And obviously interest in all hunkering down, keeping borders to a large extent, control still on a lot of borders. The next one is China first. So this is where China, even though it's not fully recovered, sees an opportunity in the developing world. And we've seen already, again, before the crisis with Belt and Road. So they're thinking, you know, because the first world, you could say the Western world, is still very much inward looking, that this is an area where they can ramp up what already exists, which, you know, and they are willing for geopolitic purposes to make certain sacrifices at home, actually, to increase that influence abroad, mainly through commercial economic means. That hasn't started. I think, you know, China itself seems to be still hunkered down. They don't have a big fiscal program like they did and stimulus program like they did before. So we haven't yet seen, I think, this direction develop, but I think it's early days. And the final one is the Renaissance. So this is the one which takes a leaf out of the 2008 financial crisis, and basically where G20 becomes the platform for thinking about cooperation. And this comes after a period, you would say, where we're headed much more in the great acceleration downward, but that doesn't prove to be very productive for anyone. And this is where global leadership comes in. And I can see a different leadership. I think it would have to be in the US, which believes much more in multilateralism. And then you would really center it on this question of vaccine, which we discussed with the ambassadors. And then after that, thinking about future pandemics, but also other big challenges. So the scenario talks about a warning agency that really has some teeth, starting with pandemics, but moving to climate change, to state failure, some of these issues where, you know, there are common interests by all the great powers to deal with them. So that leads a renaissance. It doesn't necessarily diminish all the tensions, the geopolitical tensions between US and China and others, but it is a way of opening up what I think we haven't seen in the past few years, a new area for cooperation.
All right, thanks so much. Matt, I want to turn to Rebecca now, and I do want to ask about some of the things that Matt mentioned in terms of ways we can build on the existing infrastructure around healthcare, in particular, a warning system. It's an interesting idea, but I do want to start. I want to move us from the future back into the present for a moment, because you know, as we heard at the end of the previous panel, there was some breaking news today. The U.S. is officially withdrawing from the World Health Organization. So, Rebecca, I wanted to ask you about, first of all, the implications of that move, and maybe just more broadly, you know, if we're talking about elements of the global system and how they've handled this particular crisis and how they can be improved in the future, how does that apply to the WHO and maybe the broader global infrastructure around healthcare?
Yeah, thanks for that. It's definitely an exciting day today. The Trump administration, it appears, has submitted notification to UNSG on intent to withdraw. Now that by the rules of the WHO would go into effect July 6, 2021. So I think that I think it is important to remember that if there happens to be a change of administration in January, I would imagine that 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 intent would be withdrawn. On the other hand, we also have a situation where PAHO, the Pan American Health Organization, it was recently reported that they will probably become insolvent by September due to lack of funding. And that is, that's from the US being in arrears, as well as some other countries not paying their dues. So we have some serious challenges with the institutions that we have that are governing global health in the middle of a pandemic. I've been particularly critical of this decision, and I think it is. I think that there's a lot of challenges with the WHO, but. As some of the ambassadors noted, removing funding in the middle of a pandemic just does not seem like a wise idea. Now, but that gets us into what systems do we need and where do we go from here? And I have to say that I tend to, and this was one of the things highlighted in the report, was that I tend to want to double down first on strengthening the institutions we have before trying to create brand new ones. And the WHO and CDC, for that matter, have been at a bit of a disadvantage. WHO, we've never actually fully funded. And so they are operating with the budget of, say, a mid-sized hospital, not and then they kind of they don't always make it to the final text because as countries and capitals start thinking through what the potential implications could be for them. But I do think that as we move forward, I'm still going to double down on the need to strengthen WHO before we tear it apart. At the same time, there's clearly going to need to be a lot of review about what they do, how they do it. I'm in one hand arguing like let's strengthen them. On the other hand, like I also struggle with the line that they've drawn. I really, even just taking the current debate of the week around whether or not the virus is airborne. Airborne is a tough term. It's been presented as kind of an all or nothing instead of along a continuum, and it seems clear that the WHO, very much like the CDC did in the beginning of this outbreak, are providing guidance to countries based on what they think the capacity is or what the resources that are available, as opposed to separating out, here's the evidence, here's what we understand, and then here's the guidance based off of the resources you have. And so to me, that's one of the things that's going to be really important to sort out. But I think so strengthening the WHO, but being clear about what their mandate is and how to implement that. And then as was mentioned in the report, we have been calling a team of researchers who have been working on this for years have been calling for a review conference for the international health regulations. I think that they were revised in 2005. They were adopted in 2007. They entered into force in 2007, and a lot changed. And now we have had a pandemic, and we've seen all the weaknesses that we always worried were there, we've now seen happen. And so there is an opportunity to make this international agreement more fit for purpose. And we all know the challenges when you reopen the text of a treaty. and the different directions that it could go if that happens. But we also know the effectiveness of borrowing from other international agreements and holding a review conference and coming to a set of understandings about how to interpret each of the articles. And so that's where we think is the next step should be on the IHR as a way to move us forward. I've been talking for a while. Let me stop there for a moment.
There are a lot of threads to pull on there, but I want to switch to the economic picture for a second and turn to Julia in terms of, you know, I think a lot of the immediate firefighting that we've seen has been done by national governments, obviously pouring money into their economies to try and keep them afloat. We did get a reference in the previous panel to what the EU is considering on a broader level. But I guess as we turn from, you know, the putting the floor in this thing to trying to figure out what the recovery looks like beyond that, how does that, does that take place in a more, you know, multilateral international way? And how does that also, to bring in an audience question, how does that integrate the developing world into the economic recovery? Because obviously they've been hit very hard even before they had a number of cases. The economic shocks have hit them hard too. So that's a few questions piled on top of each other, but over to you.
Sure, thanks a lot. The first thing I would say is that the crisis is, you know, an economic externality like we never could have imagined. It's like an alien landing we learned in economics class. It's sort of like taking your phone and taking a photo and just hitting the filter saturate on all of the economic fractures that, again, as Rebecca said, we knew existed but have just been exacerbated by this crisis. In the United States, this is showing fractures in our social system, showing how so many people are living really on a shoestring, and highlighting some domestic policy changes that I think will occur regardless of who's winning in November to some one degree or another. And in Europe, I think, you know, you're really looking at the unhealed wounds or the unfinished project of European integration of both fiscal and monetary reform. Again, the extraordinary steps so far standing, there's certainly a lot left to be done. There are three things that I would highlight here that we're watching at the Atlantic Council. The first would be stock markets and what they mean. The second is investment and the future of FDI. And the third is more sort of a concept of fractured growth. And again, I think, Dave, as you alluded to, who's going to recover after this? As for the markets, I think we at the beginning of the crisis, we were looking to 2008 as a model and to say, can the markets be a reflection of the overall health of the economy and its stability? But then let's face it, that was a banking crisis. This is a financial crisis, a financial meltdown. This is obviously very, very different. To me, the high stock and market values reflect a mad discrepancy between the markets themselves and the real economy. And the high stock market values are actually a warning signal to me to say there is so much liquid capital that's circling around in the ether with nowhere to go and nowhere to cycle back to the real economy into a way that creates jobs. And also shows that all of the injections that the Fed undertook in sort of creative, very, very creative ways, isn't quite working yet either, right? It's going into the pot and stirring around. The second is on foreign direct investment, which of course, referencing back to the previous panel, is a tool of economic statecraft to tie ourselves together. What we need to watch out is whether we're gonna see a lot of reshoring of investment, right? Whether this is going to be driven by the markets or driven by governments themselves. Now, a lot of these things will, you know, you can shorten the value chain. You know, there are you know, good reasons for that too, many of them being environmental. So for being higher economic, frontline economic cost, you're achieving efficiencies of another order. But we also have to look at whether government policies, and I think Matt talked about this too, sort of highlighting protectionism, what the interplay is to what, who's going to be driving the reshoring, right? Is it going to be markets saying, okay, we're going to operate closer to home, a little bit USMCA style, or are there going to be very concrete government policies to say, it's actually a national security risk to make ourselves so interconnected and try to pull these things back. And a lot of domestic policies, you know, that are looking at, you know, rejuvenating domestic economies and also area, strategic areas, not only PPE, but looking at tech, could have also a reshoring effect as every country sort of says, okay, take a look back, where did we fail? So that's a major factor that we're watching. The third is whether we're going to see a very, very varied financial recovery and what sort. Are advanced economies going to recover as fast as developing economies? We don't know, right? Because of the overall downstream macroeconomic effects. Now, of course, the IMF released its latest figures and showed very optimistic recovery for 2021 for developing economies. But of course, these calculations are done all things being equal, right? You can't actually work in all of the variables that are really going to tell us what the economy is going to look like. So going to the, considering the developing world, they could end up seeing themselves come out of it, you know, a stronger, you know, at least nominally speaking, than we do. And what you can see as the value chains start to shift and sort of localization of value chains, right, within the developing world. So Latin America, you know, trades more amongst itself. Africa trades more within itself as well. That these new constellations can lead to different areas of growth. You know, hopefully we're going to see some sort of U, we are not going to bet on that.
Great. Thanks so much, Julie. And there's a couple audience questions I want to get to, but quickly for Matt, because the question Julia asked about who recovers, right? That's actually one of the key variables in your scenarios. One of the big questions is, does China recover much more quickly than the United States? And what does that mean for geopolitics? Can you expand a bit on how, you know, how the economic recovery then plays into what we see geopolitically going forward? That's for Matt. I don't know if I said that. Yeah.
Well, I think there is this question, if you have the fractured growth, you know, I think in my mind, that's going to lead a lot more to resentments, say if China actually pulls out of this, which you have some indicators that it is starting to pull out, and the US and Europe are still by the end of the year through next year, really still in minus growth, unemployment very high, then I think it ramps up, you know, what Julia mentioned, I mentioned on protectionism, really, you know, trying to push back on China. And I think there's a political, you know, governments always defensive about this, why is the other guy doing better? And so in a sense, you want to pull them down a little bit. I don't think that's the right answer, but I think that politically, you know, that's going to win out. And that's what I think the real danger about the fractured outcome for this. I guess I'm very worried about the middle classes in the developing world, because you've had over the past couple of decades this actually marvelous, miraculous development of millions and millions pulling themselves out of poverty into the middle class. And for Latin America, for parts of Africa and Asia, you could actually see them slide back. And we know in many ways that was the story of the 1920s and 1930s in Europe with the middle class that really was eviscerated by the end of the economic depression and also the end of the First World War. So I think that is a big worry. And geopolitically, I do that, think that means less cooperation, you know, within Latin America or within Africa. And I also think for some states, I mean, there's a viability question too.
And we have a question from the audience that picks up a bit on some of the things you hit on, Matt, but it's on the security side of things. And Barry, maybe to you on this one, the question is about, obviously, I don't want to differentiate between public health and security, because we've learned from the Atlantic Council papers and others that this really is a national security issue, right? I mean, we have hundreds of thousands of people, in harm's way. But Barry, I want to ask you about, the military dimension. What threats are we seeing arise, as kind of the ripple effects from this pandemic? And what should we be doing to prepare for that new landscape as we come out of the pandemic?
Sure, thanks. I mean, I think there's two types of threats. I mean, Matt, kind of his last comment there kind of pointed to one of them, and that is you have the possibility, in particular in the developing world, of unstable states, very fragile states, collapsing over time, and that itself creates security threats, and even pre-collapse, you have the potential for the breeding of radicalization and extremism, which is kind of not getting much of the headlines these days, as we understand, but it sure isn't going away. And I think the restiveness, alienation, dim employment prospects across much of the world, including in some parts of the developed world, could also lead to those types of threats. And then there's also the nation state threats, the great power competition that has seemingly accelerated. I wrote a piece a few weeks ago that said the chances of conflict are higher now than they were before the crisis. There's just increased chances for miscalculation, for misunderstanding, readiness. And so I think it's pretty healthy and stabilizing, for example, for what the United States has done in the Pacific, surging carriers to the Western Pacific, so China doesn't get the wrong impression that the United States doesn't have the capabilities to help defend Taiwan and to help defend other U.S. interests. But at the same time, and I think we heard the Australian ambassador point to this, I think we have to prepare for the next set of national security concepts and challenges, and that certainly now includes bio capabilities, bio defense. Does anybody think that Kim Jong-un and other leaders like that aren't going to now see, wow, we can bring the world to its knees. This is the best weapon I could possibly develop. I know there's a lot of technical issues about control and everything else, but I do think that is an increased threat. And certainly the next national security strategy for the United States will have to address security against pandemics if it's going to have any support among the many Americans who are locked at home or who have lost loved ones during this pandemic. So that's kind of a brief snapshot of the kinds of things that I think are priorities.
Great. And we're running low on time here, but Rebecca, I want to turn back to you on something that really will impact the outcome of every scenario that we talked about here, which is the vaccine issue. Yeah. And we heard in the last discussion actually a lot of optimism from the ambassadors on the fact that they're going to do this in a multilateral way, and there will, they're committed to getting vaccines distributed to the people who need them around the world, which is basically everyone, right? And so can you talk a bit about whether you share that optimism and the challenges involved in trying to distribute a vaccine around the global population?
Yeah, well, I think that, that there's a couple things going on. I think that many countries, particularly coordinating through WHO, through the ACT, working through CEPI, there's a lot of entities that are working together on collaboration for vaccine development, and then also starting the conversations around what equitable distribution would look like. The US and China are not part of those discussions. And, so I think we have to actually say that up front. Now, there are approximately 100 different vaccine candidates that are currently being explored. Most of them are still, preclinical or in a lab. There are about a dozen, though, that are currently in human trials. That's incredible. And it's worth taking a moment to just acknowledge how incredibly fast this is in the world of vaccine development. So we have multiple candidates that are currently in trial. The amount of money that has been going into bets, I mean, countries are taking bets on some of the vaccine candidates and going through and making sure that there's manufacturing capacity in place not knowing if these vaccine candidates will actually be safe or efficacious. But they're investing in the hope that one of these candidates will. So a lot of money is going into making vaccines that we actually at this point have no idea if they're going to work or not. I think, though, at least from preliminary data that are coming out of the clinical trials, it looks like there will probably be one or maybe two or even three vaccine candidates that is safe and effective, at least effective-ish. I don't know if the first one that becomes available will necessarily be, I don't want to say 100% effective. I think you're looking at maybe, if you're lucky, like 70% effective. I think I'm really very concerned in making sure that whatever is developed is safe, because if it's not safe, the challenges we've had in the public health community with vaccine hesitancy for all sorts of other global health challenges will really be a very difficult battle to fight if we're up against a vaccine that is not 100% safe. But I think that's probably true. I think there probably will be a vaccine that will be available to some parts of the population, probably around the end of the calendar year, maybe the beginning of 21. I think there's probably a very good chance that this time next year, there will be, if not the same vaccine candidate, some vaccine candidate that will be available for a larger portion of the population that people will actually hopefully want to line up and get, and that will have additional safety and efficacy data on. So I think things are moving forward incredibly fast. There will no doubt be challenges, not only with the fights over who gets it and how that's distributed equitably around the world, but also with supply chain. So we may run out of glass. I mean, we already know that the supplies that would be associated with a vaccine, we may have shortages of. It's unclear if this is the vaccine that is developed would require one or two doses, how you maintain cold chain. It's going to be a massive logistical challenge. But I think the fact that the scientific community has moved us as far along as they have to date is really astonishing.
Well, we made it to a relatively optimistic place there, actually, toward the end of the discussion. We're running out of time here. So, Barry, I want to turn it over to you for the last word. I could have gone for ages. Thanks so much to everybody for taking part in the discussion. And thanks to the Atlantic Council for putting it all together.
Yeah, thank you. I'd like to talk for another couple hours with everyone. I'm learning so much, and it's really important insights. I just want to thank everyone for joining us today at this important event highlighting cooperation among Democratic partners and also the launch of a forward-thinking three-part Atlantic Council strategy paper series. It's a special series about shaping the post-COVID world together, and we really welcome your comments. We would love for you to stay engaged as we work together to try to shape this this post-pandemic world for the better. And we look forward to you joining us at future events, and we also wish you good health. Thanks very much, everyone.